Thank you and good morning. You know, it's been 13 years since Bill Gates sent an email to staff talking about the Trustworthy Computing Initiative. And it's always great to go to RSA, and I really enjoy it because as an annual event, it gives you a chance to reflect a bit. And what I want to share with you today is a little bit about the past, a little bit about the present, and a little bit about the future. And it really, you know, I'm going to echo some of the things Amit said in his keynote about the threats and the terrain. But of course, we have to continue to not just react to these events, but proactively try and prevent them. And every time we've looked at trustworthy computing over the last, 13 years, we concluded the three pillars were basically right. It is about security, privacy, and reliability as we become increasingly dependent on these systems. But as we move to the cloud, something else has happened. There are new attributes that people are starting to think about, and that's transparency and control. And the reason for that is as you move to this new cloud environment, which has huge security implications, which I think are mostly positive that I'll talk about, but as people move to this new environment, the question is how do they control that environment, and how much transparency do they get into what's happening in that environment? Now, when I say transparency and control, I'm going to put in a modifier, appropriate transparency and control. Everyone in this room probably has customers and clients who have NDAs. Being transparent doesn't mean you disclose customer information. The question is, when do you allow control? When do you provide transparency, and what does that look like? So as I started thinking about these themes, I also started thinking and going back and thinking about what the old model looked like pre-cloud. It was kind of interesting. You had vendors who built technology. We put that technology in the hands of customers, and customers had to secure it. And of course, the bad guys came along, as everyone expected. And offense beats defense on the internet. We all know what those challenges are. But basically, we've been, attacked through four attack vectors. There's the supply chain, vulnerabilities in code, configurations of systems, and social engineering. And so in this old world, we gave this technology to the customers and said, those are the things we have to work on collectively. Supply chain might be more for vendors, but configurations could be in the hands of the customers, although limited or enabled by what features were in the technology. And so you think about that model, and we're all working together to deal with the bad guys. And in that environment, if you go back to 2004, we started implementing changes in the way we built code and operated things. We really, went with this mantra of SD3, secure in design, secure in, by default, and secure in deployment. We built out the SDL, the security development lifecycle, made it available. SDL-like development is now a standard, ISO 27034. We changed the way we updated systems. We went to a regular patching cadence, all those things. And these things basically improved the state of play, but the threat models kept getting worse. And in 2007, at RSA, I did a keynote on establishing end-to-end trust. What I basically says, look, between 2002, when Bill announced trustworthy computing, and 2007, we had done all this work, but the world was as dangerous as ever, if not more so. And we started thinking about how we would build a more, preventative infrastructure. And we talked about building trusted stacks. The theory was you had to root security in hardware. You needed trusted boot processes. You needed applications that you could control and trust. And you needed to deal with the identity problem, which is still a problem. As Amit said, credential theft. Credentials are what are harvested by APTs and others, so that they look like legitimate users to the system. I tell you that because what I said back then and what I've said repeatedly at RSA is it's great to have a strategy, but a strategy is just talk. For the computer security industry writ large, these strategies only make a difference if these things are actually implemented and put in the hands of customers. And so when I thought back about what we've talked about at RSA and building trusted stacks, it turns out that even today we continue on that course, and there are some big changes coming that will be really important in building a safer infrastructure. But of course, at the same time, the world has continued to change. 3 years ago, in 2012, I talked about the three major forces of change happening in the world. The first was the change in the cyber threat, the move from opportunistic threats to advanced persistent threats. And the interesting thing is that threat model has continued to evolve in a very, very critical way. It's not just all the breaches that continue unabated, it's that the attacks have become more destructive. This fundamentally changes the way people think about securing their networks. And the reason for that is when exploitation happens, when data is stolen, it can have an impact. It can have a huge impact, but it doesn't have an immediate impact. So if someone steals your customer list and pricing list, it may be over the course of 3 or 4 years, your customers are slowly being siphoned off and your business is going under. But when someone steals your car, the minute you go outside, you know you have a bad day, right? So there's really a difference when things are destructive and attacks are becoming more destructive. Now, the intelligence community a few months ago talked about a destructive attack going back as far as 2008, where someone accessed oil pipelines in the Middle East, shut off the sensors, shut off the cameras, pressurized the pipeline, and caused a kinetic explosion. But since that time, we've had, you know, RasGas and Saudi Aramco and Sony Pictures. Destructive attacks change the conversation. Because while it may be true that intellectual property theft and economic espionage is the greatest transfer of wealth in history, as Keith Alexander has claimed, the fact is destructive attacks stop you from doing your daily business. And it is the nature of those attacks that has changed the conversation outside of the security community and in the executive suites and in the boardrooms. I can't tell you how many times now CISOs say to me, I'm going to talk to the board of directors. How should I describe this terrain that we live in? How do I make it understandable? So the change in the threat model is really key. The second big change, of course, is the cloud and big data and mobility. Because as people migrate to the cloud, they have to let go of control of stuff. It changes the relationship between the vendors who used to provide the technology to the customers to manage on-prem to customers saying, okay, I'm putting my stuff in your cloud. How should I think about trust models in that environment? And it's really interesting because as a cloud builder, one of the things you realize, of course, is you love your customers, but some of them may be up to no good. You know, in the original Sony attack way back when, some of the denial of service packets were coming out of cloud providers. And so as you build up a cloud, you say, wow, we're going to have all these VMs, and we love our customers, and hopefully they're great customers. But organized crime groups and terrorist organizations and other bad people can subscribe to cloud services. How are we going to protect the fabric from those VMs? And you start building this technology, protect the fabric from the VMs, protect the fabric from the VMs. Then you start talking to the customers in the cloud, and they say, how do we protect our VMs from your fabric? How do we protect our stuff from your system administrators? It's not that we don't trust you. If we didn't trust you, we wouldn't do business with you. But there's a lot of concern. You know, in the old world, it was the government and vendors and customers fighting the bad guys. But in a post-Snowden world, it's like, yes, we're still all fighting the bad guys, but we all have a little bit of concern about each other. We want technically enforced trust boundaries and transparency into those things. So the cloud is changing that equation. And then there's, of course, the government relationship with the internet. I've talked about this before at RSA. There are enterprises with customers who are citizens. There are protectors of the internet. And around the world, you see increased regulatory action and certification regimes. They're exploiters of the internet. They hoard zero days, and they do espionage programs, and they want access to data for public safety and national security, access to lots of data. And that's why we're having a crypto debate again, because they're worried that they're going to go dark and aren't being able to fulfill their government mission. So you have to think about this new world in light of these changes that we talked about 3 years ago and how these changes continue to change and evolve. So what does that look like? Well, if in the old world you had, you know, vendors giving technology to customers and trying to protect against the bad guys, the new world is a little bit more complex. Because now vendors are giving technology to customers, and customers are sending data back to the vendor to do big data and analytics, and they're using platform and infrastructure as a service, and they want to be able to take their software and put their software in the cloud, and they want to be protected from the cloud at the same time that they leverage the cloud. And in this cloud, there's not just the three good guys, but the bad guys too. They're all sharing the same cloud. So this is the environment now in the terrain we find ourselves in. So what does that mean? How do you start thinking about, okay, we still have to do security. It's about risk mitigation, not risk elimination. But how do we better mitigate in this environment? What are the core ways to think about that? So when we thought about this further, we said, you know what? The three core pillars are still right. It is still about security, reliability, and privacy. Those are really the core tenets that we have to have in any system that we're all going to rely on. At the same time, users want more control and more transparency about what's happening in the new cloud world. And as I said, you need appropriate control and transparency, and you also have to deal with our visceral reactions about some of this stuff. So people do have visceral reactions about control. When you feel you're in control, you are happier. You know, it's absolutely true. This is why you can talk to so many people who say, I would rather drive than fly, it's safer. And you go, of course it's not safer. The difference is when you're in the car, you're in control. And I used to tell the story and say, you see, so control is, you know, not all it's cracked up to be. But then I started teaching my two oldest kids how to drive. And I'm in the passenger seat, and they have the steering wheel and the brakes, and I realized control really matters. And so when I started thinking about that, I said, okay, so how should a company like Microsoft and other cloud providers start thinking about control and transparency? And I then started thinking about both the fact that, to be blunt, we're not all in the cloud. No one's all in the cloud. People are hybrid. They're running things on-prem. They still have to deal with identity management problems. We still need the trusted stacks that I talked about in 2007. And we also have to deal with this model in the cloud. And so as I got ready for RSA, I started looking back and thinking about the things I had said over the course of the last 8 years or so, and then looking forward to Windows 10, to our cloud services, to what's coming, and said, have we always been faithful to TWC? And are we amending TWC to reflect this sense of transparency and control? And so I want to share just three slides with you. Because, as I said, strategy is just talk. The question is, are you implementing things in your products and services to say the strategy is coming to life? So the first thing is, and you heard this in Amit's talk, and I mentioned it earlier, we have a huge problem with usernames and passwords. And it's not just that they get stolen and phished and everything else, but people reuse them everywhere, so if you lose it in one place, you've lost it in a lot of places. We all know we need to move to a different system. And the system really has two parts. One is about how you authenticate to your device, and Windows Hello and Windows 10 is about biometric authentication. And it's also about more personal computing. That is, your computer will recognize you and you will have a relationship with the machine. As you know, we heard earlier, machines are changing. They are becoming more interactive with people. And the reason this is important is because one of the places we have fallen down as a community is security usability. When we knew usernames and passwords weren't enough, we built one-time passwords with SMS to a phone, so you have to get your phone and unlock your phone and retype a code, like retyping is really a security feature. You know, we had all this stuff that we didn't make easy enough to use. And as a result of that, you can build it, but they won't come. So when we get to a point where computers are more personal, when they recognize you biometrically and in a secure way, then you're in a position to say, okay, now you really don't need a username and password, especially if you can not just authenticate to your machine, but send that authentication in a robust way to a relying party. You know, way back when we made investments in TPMs, and I'll talk more about this, the original, you know, TPM feature was BitLocker, using hardware roots of trust, which I talked about in 2007, to encrypt. But it turns out, of course, you can use TPMs for a lot more. And if you start signing credentials with TPMs and then transmit them, then the relying party knows that the credential's coming from the machine it expects, which means you can still steal my credential and you can go to another machine and type my username and password. But if it's not signed by the TPM, the relying party will know that this is not the machine that's expected. That kind of technology, if it's embedded in a way that people can actually use it easily, will deal a lot with the phishing things, because what will happen is your credential will get phished, but it can't be played from another place. So Windows Hello and Microsoft Passport are designed to bring those technologies to life and be consistent with our philosophy that we need to move to hardware roots of trust, biometrics, and we finally need to kill usernames and passwords. We also talked about, in the trusted stack, having trusted applications and trusted boot. And of course, with TPMs, you can do trusted boot. You can know what your operating system should boot to, and you can do attestation that the boot process worked the way you thought. And then you can lock down with device guard applications so you only run trusted applications. To be clear, none of this is a panacea, right? The terrain is dangerous. What you want to do, though, is narrow the attack surface so you can worry about less and also be more intelligent about what you look for. When you're seeing all that big data analytics from all your IDS sensors and logging data and proxy logs, and it helps if you can narrow down the things that are of interest so you can be more effective in your response. I talked about TPMs, but also important is people want control, particularly in this post-Snowden world, about what crypto they use, particularly governments. You know, one of the Snowden allegations was that the NSA may have tweaked an algorithm that was a NIST-approved algorithm to provide some sort of access. Well, in TPM 1 and 1.2, you have the SHA-1 algorithm. In TPM 2.0, which is now going through the standardization of the ISO process, you get crypto agility. That is, governments can go, and governments are most concerned about this, they can go to their OEM vendor and say, in my TPM chips, I want this algorithm. I don't want to be dependent on an algorithm chosen for me by a vendor. I want crypto agility. I want to be able to pick my own algorithm. So that's really important if you think about user control. Azure Key Vault. As you move to the cloud, how do you think about key management? Well, we know the key management systems are stronger and more robust if they're rooted in hardware. So you use hardware security modules and you create services that let people manage their encryption better. And then in Office 365, you know, sometimes people want to have enough control and know that if they ever find it necessary for whatever reason, they can deny their cloud provider access to the mail. And the easiest way to do that is revoke a key. And so you give the customer control and say, if you want to revoke the key, you can do that. And so suddenly customers are saying, well, I'm worried about putting in the cloud. Like, how do I make sure the data is ever destroyed? One of the big privacy principles is destruction of data when no longer needed. Now you have this capability. It also allows you to think about innovations and cost savings, which is important in security in new ways. Let me give you an example. When we deployed BitLocker at Microsoft, we did what most customers did. We put it on our mobile devices. Why? Because people were leaving laptops in cabs and at airports and all that. And so it was about mobility. Over time, we actually shifted. We deployed BitLocker on all our desktops. You say, why? Mobility? Theft of desktops? No, not at all. Cost savings. What happened was we have these desktops, and there comes a time when they're end of life. You don't throw them away. You give them to charities. You give them to schools. You donate them. But of course, you got to wipe all the data. And wiping the data is time consuming, it's expensive, and sometimes people miss. You can find articles in the paper that some school bought some computers and they found some sensitive IP on this computer. Why? Because the wiping process just missed it. It turns out if you deploy BitLocker on your desktops, when you're ready to donate it, you just pull the hard drives from the machines. You take the hard drive away from the TPM, the data can never be recovered. Suddenly, it's much easier to donate machines. It's much more cost effective. So if we continue to innovate in those ways with these technologies, with hardware roots of trust, we'll make, you know, huge progress in that regard. Control. Customers also say, how can the cloud be more like my environment? See, because when you're on-prem, you get to decide what to deploy. You get to decide what logs to look at. you get to manage. And one of the problems is, when you move your technology into the cloud, you lose some of that control. You absolutely do lose some of it. I've had customers say to me, look, on-prem, we run IDS. We want to run IDS on your cloud, on your infrastructure, on your backbones. You go, really? It's multi-tenanted. You really want to do deep packet inspection of your competitor? They go, that would be nice. Then they laugh and say, no, we don't really mean that. But the fact is that there are certain things that the cloud provider is going to do, and you're going to have to rely on the cloud provider. But there are other things that you're going to want to do, that you're going to want to maintain control of. So creating a cloud environment where you can have virtual appliances, you can have your own WAN optimizers, you can have your own, you know, network devices used in the cloud environment becomes critical. The other thing is that people want transparency. So if we have all these things, if the cloud is doing all of this, how much of it are you going to expose to us? And this is a journey, literally, as these technologies become more and more mature. Look, Microsoft has always had transparency in some areas. We have the government security program. We make our source code available to governments. Why? Because they were worried about backdoors. And they said, be more transparent. So we made our code available. We published transparency reports, as do other big cloud providers, about the law enforcement requests we're getting. But now in this cloud environment, customers say, we want more transparency about what's happening in the network. What's happening with our VMs? Who's getting access? All of those things. And so by creating management activity APIs, now customers can go to the cloud but still see what's happening. It's transparency for them. And then in a great mixture of transparency and control, you have the lockbox. Why? We know that system administrator privileges have long been a problem. People have persistent domain administration. Their credentials are used in too many boxes. You don't have domain isolations. You look at the sophisticated APTs, they harvest credentials, and then they move laterally across the network. So people know domain administration has been a problem for a long time. If you look at the Defense Signals Directorate recommendations out of Australia, they said four things dealt with almost all of the APTs that they were grappling with. Get on the latest software, keep it updated, manage domain administration, and whitelist applications. So like any big cloud provider that has to manage our own networks and also the cloud networks that give our publicly available services, we've been focused on JIT and JIA, just-in-time administration and just-enough administration. Just-in-time administration is you give someone a token that allows them to escalate privileges to administrator level when they actually need it in a time-bounded way. No persistent administration, right? And just enough administration is give them the privileges they need so they can do what they need to do and not more. Look, Edward Snowden was a system administrator of a SharePoint site. Did he need access to all that data? So when you start thinking about that, you say, okay, let's build JIT and JIA. Let's build just-in-time administration and use it everywhere. Let's do just-enough administration. But now you can put the customer in control of that. You can say to a cloud customer, you've called us up, you want us to access a file because you think it's corrupted, you want to see if we can help recover it. We're going to need system administrative access. Instead of us granting it to ourselves, let's put you in the approval chain. You grant access. Because then when you get that access request, you'll know you actually did ask for access and you can approve it. And that's the control, but then you want transparency, which is, okay, where's the logs? Show me all the people who have accessed my stuff. Let me compare that with what I think I've authorized you to do. I think this is the trend you're going to see in the cloud, that the people are still going to want security, privacy, and reliability, but they're also going to want transparency, and they're going to want control. And it's going to behoove the cloud providers to provide that so people know what's happening with their stuff on the network. And let me just add a really important thing. You know, the keynotes are right, the terrain is dangerous and all of that, but there is a fundamental shift happening, which is because of these destructive attacks, the market has woken up. As I said, there are so many CISOs now who say, I'm talking to the CEO, I'm talking to the board. The SEC has published guidance on what boards should do about cybersecurity. There is more and more activity now. The reason that that is so critical is when the markets wake up, the markets create demand, and then the people who build technology rise up to meet the demand. I think the CSIS Commission that I had the privilege of co-chairing with Jim Lewis had it right. What we said and what I've said before is that the markets will do security, but the markets will do the security that the markets demand, and then vendors will do a little more. We have a sense of social responsibility. We want a public and safe internet. We will invest, essentially shareholder dollars, to do security that the market didn't pay for directly. But you can't make a market case for the Cold War. You can't make a market case for national security and public safety. It doesn't work. And so when you think about that model, it's always been that the governments need to fill the gap between what the market will provide and what governments think they need to protect us as citizens, to protect our public safety, and to protect the national security. The more the market demands, the more is provided by the market, the more innovation occurs, the less the government has to do. The cloud will be key, but we need technically enforced trust boundaries to ensure that those who want to migrate to the cloud have faith. And they have faith because they have control, and they have faith because they have transparency, so the faith is grounded in fact. Look, I testified before Congress about 2 months ago, and a senator said to me, you know, we're hearing about all these cybersecurity threats. How should we think about the small and medium businesses in my district? I said, get them to the cloud. A small business doesn't have an IT staff. They don't have a CISO. They don't have a SIEM. One of the great things about the cloud is that security expertise and technology gets consolidated. And it is wonderful that some of the top companies in the Fortune 1000 have big security staffs and have CISOs and have very sophisticated response processes and the like. But we have never been able to scale computer security to the entire planet. We just don't have the people to do it. But when security features and services become the backbone of the marketplace, then suddenly we can change the conversation about what great security looks like. Thank you very much, and have a great conference.